The book is Deadly Spin, and the author is Wendell Potter, who we sat down with briefly in Cleveland over the summer. And Wendell, I read as much of the book as I could over the last couple of days. I got through about 200 pages, which is really the majority of it. And number one, it's sad that you have to write this book, but congratulations on the way you wrote it and what you tell, because I was compelled. I could literally barely put it down.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
So there's a few questions I have just about, you go through your background in college and then kind of starting in journalism and then how you worked into public relations and eventually into healthcare. Growing up politically, were you a liberal guy, a conservative guy? I mean, I know you mentioned you worked briefly for a Democratic candidate in Tennessee, I believe it was. But what were your politics growing up?
Yeah, I come from probably one of the most Republican parts of the country, Northeast Tennessee, which traces its Republicanism back to the Civil War, when that part of Tennessee did not want to secede from the Union. So there were Union sympathizers, and that's my folks are from that part of the country. It's where I spent the first few years of my life. I think every relative that I know of is a Republican, so and it's culturally conservative as well. So that's how I was raised. And I when I went to college, and I was in college during the Vietnam War. And I became editor of the student newspaper, and I became more involved in political affairs and certainly much involved in what was going on during that war. And that certainly influenced me a great deal in my thinking. I went on to be a newspaper reporter, and I tried to be as objective as I could in all my writing. I felt at that time, I was largely politically agnostic, and I think I really was. I wanted to be as unbiased in my reporting as I could be. No one's truly objective totally, but I tried my best. But I did go to work for a Democratic candidate for governor of Tennessee after I had spent a few years as a reporter in Washington. And it was kind of a flip of the coin. I didn't mention this too much. I don't think I mentioned it at all in the book, but I was also offered a job by Howard Baker, who at that time was Republican senator from Tennessee and minority leader, and he became majority leader later on. I chose to go back to Tennessee and join the campaign of Jake Butcher, who was a Democratic nominee for governor.
So you go through the book. First, you worked for a, I guess, could we say it was a religiously based hospital group, or at least a religion-based hospital group? Is that fair to say?
It was. It was the Baptist Health System of East Tennessee, which was started by the Baptist Church, and it was affiliated with other Baptist health systems around the largely the Southeast. So, absolutely, that was my first real entry into the healthcare in this country, or into the healthcare system, and it operated a few hospitals, but it also had an HMO that was fairly new and fairly small. It was a regional HMO, and everything was operated on a nonprofit basis, and that was something that I learned later was pretty significant.
Well, and then in the book you go through your work eventually as vice president of corporate communications at Cigna, and of course eventually you're leaving that position because of some, I guess we could say, fundamental moral ethical conflicts with what was taking place, not just at Cigna, but really that you were exposed to across the industry. And I'd love to just get into some of those specifics, because as I read these with great interest, I had a sense for some of these things, but the way you really just outline it as purely business decisions, some of the things that were done, it's incredible. And one of those things is the medical loss ratio that you talk about. And as publicly traded companies often report earnings per share, health insurance companies also have something called a medical loss ratio, which is what portion of the money that they are receiving is being paid out as health care, as procedures and reimbursements to those premium payers. It's interesting to me that the term loss is used for paying for health care, which is essentially what the companies are there to do, is it not?
Well, that's right. It is what they're there for, and that is to meet the health care needs of the people who are policyholders. When I said I really didn't appreciate the distinction between nonprofit and for-profit healthcare when I left Baptist to go into work for actually two large healthcare corporations, Humana first and then Cigna, eventually it became very, very clear to me what the distinctions were. Medical loss ratio is something that means a lot more to shareholders on Wall Street than it does to most people. shareholders look at the medical loss ratio every quarter when these big corporations announce their earnings. They want to make sure that that number is going down. In other words, they want to make sure that the insurance company is spending less than it did the quarter before, if it possibly can at all, on paying claims and providing health care. Because the less it pays out in health care, for health care and in claims, the more is available for profits and for overhead. I didn't really know all this was going on during the early years of my time, even in work with Cigna. It was not a term that I paid a lot of attention to or that most people had ever heard of before. But toward the end of my career, one of my responsibilities after I became head of corporate communications was handling financial communications for Cigna. And that meant that I had to know how the companies made money. And I quickly found out that the medical loss ratio is one of the most important measures that Wall Street looks at, maybe even more important than the earnings per share.
So when you describe in the book on the days that the medical loss ratio was being published or announced, which I think was done quarterly, right?
That's correct.
You would know that if that number has creeped up even a fraction of a percentage point, you were going to have a long day answering questions from, is it both reporters and who else? I mean, financial people?
Well, I work very closely with the investor relations department, and we worked almost side by side when we announced earnings. And they, the investor relations team, would talk to investors and analysts, and I was a person who talked to financial reporters with the Wall Street Journal and Reuters and Bloomberg and Dow Jones and other financial publications, as well as some consumer publications, but largely financial publications. And it was every 3 months, and I would know, because I would clearly need to prep for these calls, I would know which direction the medical loss ratio had gone during the preceding quarter. And once I was observing what happened to Aetna's stock when Aetna a few years ago announced that it did not meet Wall Street's expectations, that its medical loss ratio had creeped up by a few percentage points, not even a few percentage points, but fractions of a percentage point, and its stock price went down 20% in a single day. That just gives you an idea of how closely this measure is watched by Wall Street.
So that obviously gets us into the next question, which is, as you were getting closer to that publishing date, what techniques were used to try to ensure at least that the medical loss ratio was as low as possible? And you describe a number of different ways to kind of keep profits as high as possible. Policy rescission is one we've heard about a lot recently, which is going back to people's initial applications, people in theory who are now making significant claims for care, and finding reasons to essentially say, you know what, you weren't completely honest. And it might be something as simple as saying, you know, I never included that I once had heartburn when I was 15 years younger.
Right.
Is that the most ominous tactic that was used, or what else was done?
Well, that was one. In fact, a woman testified before Congress that her insurer canceled her coverage when she was in the midst of treatment for breast cancer for failing to disclose that she had acne at some point in the recent past.
Wow.
And so she was left to pay all of those medical bills, which clearly can get into the hundreds of thousands of dollars. Another thing is what's called purging, and this is a practice that the industry uses to get rid of actually small businesses that are customers. Small businesses largely have to pay more for their coverage than big insurance companies do on a per capita basis, and their claim experience can be skewed pretty easily if one person gets sick. And when that happens, when that book of business comes up for renewal, the insurance company will largely jack the rates up so much that the small business will have no alternative but to drop coverage for everybody enrolled in that benefit plan. As a consequence of this, we're seeing that more and more people are joining the ranks of the uninsured. The practices of the insurance industry over these years has really run off a lot of business, and they only want to, if they can at all, insure people who won't need their services.
So were you privy to decisions or discussions about, you know, we really need to keep the medical loss ratio as low as possible? Let's pick a specific diagnosis that we know is very expensive for us and see how many people we can weed out. I mean, was it that pervasive?
Well, it's pervasive in the culture. everybody who works for a big corporations like Cigna or Humana or WellPoint or one of the other big companies, you understand that you have some role to play in making sure that your company meets Wall Street's expectations from both a profit and a medical loss perspective. And say, for example, you're a medical director. You're just as much of a corporate employee as I was as head of corporate PR. And you know that you've got your role to play to make sure that you don't disappoint Wall Street. So it's not necessarily that you get a memo saying let's clamp down on claims for this particular diagnosis, but you know that over the course of the quarter, you need to pay attention to what you're approving or not approving for coverage.